Welcome to the ProCom podcast, hosted by Paul Vogels, with expert guest interviews, case study reviews, and insightful discussion topics. The ProCom podcast leads the project controls conversation.
Welcome, Lex. Welcome, everybody, at the ProCom podcast, leading the project controls conversation. And today I am the guest in the metropole region, Amsterdam, actually in one of the offices of the municipality of Amsterdam. My guest, Lex Brans, and I've written down all your functions, but please explain them a little bit further to me and to the audience. You have some roles which you are responsible for. Project leader of the acceleration program between the housing and all additional stuff within the metropole region Amsterdam. Construction ambassador, broader than that, but construction ambassador is the title, the working title for the province of Noord-Holland, and delegated executive for the Holland Metropole. With a background in political science, you've been to the University of Amsterdam here. All your career has been politically engaged within several roles, and now into these roles. Lex, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And please explain me why you still are so enthusiastic of all this work you have on your plate.
Actually, when I started to study, it's in 1976 or something like that.
Yeah.
I started to study in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
And, well, actually, I got in love with the city. And social housing and public housing is so important for people that working on that, working on the capital of the Netherlands, which has a real famous name all over the world.
Yeah.
Actually, it's associated more bigger than it is in fact. And that's because we can talk very, very loudly from Amsterdam, very creative.
Yeah.
And then working on a city like that.
Yeah.
Well, it's something like heaven, you know?
Yeah. Because Amsterdam has 2.5 million inhabitants,
the city itself.
Yeah.
A little bit more than 850,000 in the metropolitan area, about 2.5 million.
2.5 million. In a country which is 17 million people wide, it's an important region in the Dutch environment,
yes,
I think.
It's part of the economic backbone of the Netherlands.
Yep.
So actually, the gross product here locally is something about 22% of the whole of the Netherlands, so it's quite important.
It's quite important, yeah. That's a very and of course Amsterdam is famous for a lot of things. Mm-hmm. You fell in love with social housing. Did that pave your career path for the last dozens of years?
Well, actually, I fell in love with another student, and she was in the housing, so that's why I came into housing.
Yeah. Okay.
And I never left that path now.
No, okay. Now you're responsible for one of the, I think the bigger trends in Europe-wide, social housing in particular. People can't afford a house or there's no room to build. Is that still 30, 40 years after you started with your love and with the social housing? Is that still the big key area of the challenge the metropole region has?
You mean that we have to build a lot of houses?
We have to build. If I look at all the articles which have been written, there's a lot of challenges. Within the next 10 years, 175,000 houses. And your challenge is, among others, I assume, to speed up the process. There is, one of your interviews says, in theory, we have room enough. In practice, the processes and the political landscape is slowing this down.
Well, I think there's a small problem. It's Netherlands are very high educated old people.
Yep.
That's why this kind of TED talk is in English. You're used to it.
Yep.
As Dutch. But we are discussing a lot about how to do, but we forget to do.
Yep. I think the Dutch even have a word for it, which is not translated in English. I use it a lot. polderen. Hè? We discuss until everybody is happy.
A lot, we do that, of course, in Amsterdam as well.
Yeah.
But we polder in Amsterdam for the quality of the housing.
Yeah.
But in general, you could say our national parliament is discussing about how much capacity, so how much plan locations are there and are they enough? And
yeah.
The minister has to postpone how much that is and give an answer to actually questions that are not that important for realizing housing.
Yeah.
Houses. So there is a lot of what we call management speak or general talking about how to solve the problem.
Yep.
And then the discussion goes always about budgets. How much money does that cost? And,
yep.
Who earns the money and the rent on it,
yep.
The revenues. But we forget to plan, to work with the people and to realize projects with people in an environment
yep.
that accepts that it is there and that our new houses are coming.
Yeah, because it's pulling out all the resources out of the municipality, for example, and we're creating new cities to, it also brings a lot of value to create a good infrastructure, good housing community.
Of course, Amsterdam is very famous because the revenues are here very high, I think a little bit too high. And there's another discussion which is very important. We are talking about housing and how much houses we have to build.
Yep.
But actually, that's only 1.2% of the total stock of houses we have.
Okay.
And the rise in the prices of the houses, the rise is in the 99% stock.
Yep.
And what you build new, prices of that, they are connected to the existing market,
yep.
Housing market. And so when you discuss with politics
mm-hmm.
and politicians, they have to make decisions about the existing stock and the prices about that. And that is an international thing.
Yeah.
And Amsterdam is competing with London, Paris, and so on.
Yep.
But you see now in the European balance, Paris is on place number two, London on place number one,
yep.
about most expensive cities,
yep.
and then on place number three is Amsterdam.
Yep.
And on five is Utrecht, sixth is The Hague,
yep.
So and seven is Rotterdam, and we talk about a European list.
Yep. So only 40% maybe
that
is Dutch.
That goes about existing stock
yeah.
and the prices in that. International investors like BlackRock or name it,
yeah.
BlackRock is American, they have a bad name and, well, for a reason. They buy the houses,
yeah.
there is liberalization in the pricing market
yeah.
of the existing stock.
Yeah.
So the prices go up sky high
yeah.
and Amsterdam becomes very expensive to live in.
Yeah. And that's where our parliament needs to take us responsible to say, okay,
yes.
there needs to be like a ceiling
and
on
when
that.
You want to have a equilibrium in your prices,
mm-hmm.
social mid-price and high prices,
yep.
then you have to subsidize in the lower parts, lower segments of the
yep.
market
yep.
in, when you build new.
Yep.
And that is what we are now expecting a new cabinet.
Yep. Yeah, it takes a little while, I heard this morning in the newspaper.
Yeah. Of course, it takes a
yeah.
while. But still, the problem is there for the people who live in all those cities.
Yeah.
And well, sometimes they pay 50% of their total income
yep.
to housing.
To housing. And so because of the prices are sky high, the people with moderate budgets, like social rent or mid
yeah.
mid-career starters, for example, also a big problem, can't enter the market because their entry level is, well,
yes.
maybe on a short.
It's really a big problem for starters. When I look to my own children, I have seven children and four of them don't live in Amsterdam anymore.
No.
Because they can't afford it.
Can't
I
afford.
Cannot buy a house for them. I'm just a civil servant, you know.
Yeah. But that's so. Is that something you see as the municipality of Amsterdam that your the run for talent is draining because they can't afford the budget? They can't afford to rent a house or buy a house.
Well, that's a huge problem.
Yeah, that's
right about it.
Yeah. Very nice thing, which was in the newspaper. Lex doesn't have stones. can bring bricks or cement mills. I need to look up the term Pannenbier, which is it's like a topping out when we celebrate the highest point of a new building. But he brings support and to speed up as a building ambassador, as a construction ambassador. Mm-hmm. So with your political science background, is that what you bring? You look at people, you bring them together to say, okay, we have this challenge, how do we solve it? Or where do you see the turning of this challenge we have in the municipality of Amsterdam or in the metropole region? You are quoted, you talk a lot with municipalities.
Yes.
Is uniforming processes, bringing people together, solving it? Are we seeing the results already in the...
Uniforming is one point. I think make it more simple is another one. And when you look to the climate change, which is coming up, actually we have to redesign our whole building process.
Yep.
Which is quite a job to do. And we are only now in the beginning of that. We are now building what we want to build from 2025, 20% in wood.
Yep.
That will be CO2 neutral, carbon neutral,
yep,
circular, and climate adaptive. So that's great,
yep,
but it did need a redesign of the processes.
Yep.
Make it more simple, not adding another layer to the rules that there are,
yep,
but just like, for example, Volkswagen,
yep,
they started with a new plant. So no modifications on the existing,
yep,
stream, but a new plant. Now, we do that now for wood.
Yep.
That's 20%. So we have to do that for the other 80%.
As well. Yep.
And as quick as possible.
Yeah, because we are, the challenges are coming up. Huh? We've seen all the climate reports,
yes,
et cetera.
Yes, yes.
I think you're a strong believer in modular building, in wood building, and at least to speed up the process.
Yeah.
The construction and engineering industry, mm-hmm, is famous about the conservative mindset they have. Is that hard to reset the mindset? Eh? Do you see within the existing landscape of builders and contractors that they are resetting their mindset, or are there new kids on the block who say, okay, we don't have the years of experience in building, but we do modular building, prefab building, wood building, etc. Is that where you see the possibility comes in?
Well, I believe in the younger generation, yes. And what you see is that in the traditional building scene, there are quite a lot of old guys,
yep,
in the old boys network.
Yes.
And they are also influencing in Den Haag, in The Hague.
Yep.
The political parties, and when you have to redesign your process, well, I believe in startups.
Yeah, yeah, because they don't have the backlog of all what we've done before builders to this.
Being there, done that.
Yeah,
they don't have that.
No. But you see, for example, there's a really famous bridge right now in Amsterdam, 3D printed in metal.
Yeah.
The sitting old boys network is trying its best as well. They are investing in 3D printing houses with etc.
Yes, of course. It's all in the sphere of experimenting, pilots, and so on.
Yeah.
But I think the ongoing concern, just normal processes, they have to be redesigned.
Yeah.
Which is something else,
yeah,
I believe. And I talked a few minutes ago about simplifying your processes.
Yep.
That's very important. Also in the municipalities, I work for 32 municipalities in the metropolitan area.
Yep.
And in the province, another one, another 10th or so.
Mm-hmm.
So in total, 40, 45,
yep,
municipalities.
Yep.
And I see that the knowledge about the processes is not high enough to make it work in a quick way.
Yep.
So when you simplify your processes, it helps them to understand what they have to do. And well, they have easier lists, to-do lists,
yep,
and bucket lists.
Yep.
And I think that's very important. Yep.
Did we overcomplicate our running a business or running a municipality, which in fact is also
which
running
is
a business?
Also typical Dutch, of course,
yep,
poldering, you know?
Yep.
So everybody gets his part.
Gets a sign, yeah.
And I think that's a very good thing. But we have to realize the situation we are in is a different situation than 10 years ago.
Yep.
Our crisis is different. It's a climate crisis,
yep.
Not a corona crisis, which is only, or COVID, which is only, well, let's say a startup in what is going to happen in the world.
Yep. Well, yes, I think so. We faced a lot of crises the last 10, 15 years. Yeah, there was this building crisis, financial crisis, etc. Were they overcomplicating this? 32 municipalities in the metropole region, they all are autonomous. They all are responsible for their own business, their own municipality.
Yes, we all want to build, you know.
Yep. So do you get the hands together? Do you get a listening ear if you talk to the board of mayor and alderman, for example? Say, well, we need to team up together to face this crisis, but also to face this challenge in the housing shortest. And on the other hand, the parliament needs to step up as well. But do you get, if you talk to 32 directors and mayors, etc., do you get a listening voice or listening ear to that?
Yes, I do. And I see a lot of energy in almost every city I pass by to have a conversation about the housing crisis and what we can do about that. On the other hand, I think it's very important to realize that it's people's work.
Yep.
It's not system work. The system, systems, they help you to realize your targets within time and budget.
Yep.
But how you steer your processes, it's people's work.
Yep.
And for that, we need elements who have power, who want to have power, and who get room from their local municipalities, the local boards, to act. Because a lot of people want more houses, but have a lot of NIMBY behavior, which has as a result that all the plans, they go 3-4 times what we call in Holland over the head.
You know? Yeah. Yeah.
So every time I turn around, start again, start the discussion again. Well, we don't build houses with that.
No, because it's all delaying. We're talking about the same issue. Maybe the political landscape has changed, so the new alderman wants to say something about it with his agenda. I really like your saying, its processes should facilitate. People should, at the end, it's all a people's job. Within the ProCon podcast, we always talk about people, processes, and tools.
Yeah.
What are the tools you have to measure your goals or to influence people, because data is running the world nowadays? Are there supporting data? Can you see why this amount of delays or this amount of going over the head results in delaying
Yes, there are a few common cliffhangers, you could say, in the processes, which I can see about which we discuss. So, for example, the behavior of a local board, that's one, but also all the climate measures we have to do.
Yep.
About CO2, for example.
Yep.
Also PFAS.
PFAS is a really big crisis within the construction.
We have the airport here in the area, which makes a lot of noise. So that makes it not so easy to build. Those processes we get from our systems.
Yep.
And that's very important to have real data to talk about, because there is a lot of hearsay.
Yep. A lot of gut feeling. I think it's too loud in my backyard.
Well, you know, in our world we work in, the housing world, investing.
Yep.
It's a lot of money that goes around. It's only last year in the Netherlands, the investment volume was almost 20 billion.
Yep.
Which is quite a lot. And that happens every year.
Yep.
So there goes a lot of money around. And what we see is that, well, investors sometimes follow another investment just by talk of the town.
Yeah.
Just by hearsay. And well, I want us to work professional, not on hearsay, mm-hmm. but on what is happening.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the legal procedures are cliffhangers.
Yeah.
The NIMBYs are cliffhangers. The behavior of the local governments are cliffhangers.
Yeah.
And the rulings about everything. So there are four big issues.
Yeah.
Which also, we have to talk about that and not about hearsay. One of the most things, hearsay is, for example, there is still a lot of investment in London.
Yeah.
But the revenues are low.
Yeah.
But everybody has to invest in London.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but everybody has to with it.
Yeah.
Strange, huh?
Yeah.
But it happens.
Do you have that supporting data available? Because you can measure how much money is invested in London, how much revenue will be generated by London. Yeah. And I think one of a good example is getting the European Medicine Agency out of London. And thank God Amsterdam won it. It was a very prestigious project. There was a lot of money involved. Yeah, there was a lot of...
I'm just still angry on that.
Yeah, still angry on that. But at the end, we did the job. We won it. There are people actually working right now. We've seen the building built by, I think, Dura Vermeer and Heijmans built the actual offices in time. Let's discuss budget later on. But the people could move from London to Amsterdam. On all this... challenges, green, noise from the airport, PFAS, nitrogen, etc. Is the supporting data available for that?
Well, we're building it up. We started with the data systems of the city of Amsterdam.
Yep.
Because half of the production in the whole metropolitan area is in Amsterdam.
Yep. In the city center?
In the city.
Yeah, in the city. Okay.
So that's within the ring or just around the ring.
Yeah.
Let's say the city of Amsterdam.
Yeah.
And they produce 7,000 houses a year and already for a long time.
Yeah.
So Amsterdam is very professional and they have data sets which they use to measure how their processes are going. Actually, we have two main frameworks. The first one is the planned capacity.
Yeah.
It's actually more... where do we want to build?
Yep.
And is there enough room for building? So that we know in the planned capacity frame that over 500,000 houses, the places are available.
Yeah. That's the, in theory, we have the room to build.
We have, in theory, we can build.
Yeah.
Enough. And then the other one is the framework, which usually is used by MS Projects or Primavera.
Yep.
Two programs. We use them both.
Yep.
And we introduce those systems in every city of the area, metropolitan area.
And that's the bridge between the, in theory and in practice, we actually have this. I think Havestad is a great project in the Amsterdam. We actually have planned, I don't know the exact number, but a couple of thousand houses in these regions, mid-market, sub-market, social housing, etc. Yeah. That's where you actually know what you're building on actually which square feet in the city.
Yeah, and also what I call the critical path to come there.
Yep.
Which is very important.
Yes.
So you can look to the sky and think, well, I think we start building within 2 years.
Yep.
But is the legal process done in a proper way or?
Yeah.
Do we have procedures up to the national level?
Yeah.
To the national
but that can be, you can have a smart process on that. There's a 6-week ruling period. There's we need 2 weeks to prepare something. We need whatever. But you can sketch that out. You can schedule that actually. Mm-hmm. And you see, if we want to build 5,000 houses by the end of 2023, for example, it is possible. This is what you're referring to. This is your critical path. So if something changes on that path, we're going to delay. That's coming more in common practice within the municipalities you're referring to.
Well, actually, we have the 80-20% rule.
So yeah.
80% of the result or 20% of the
efforts.
Energy on effort on it. So actually, we work with 8-9 big cities.
Yep.
Which have the 85% of the whole production.
Yeah, and in the last quarter, there will be an additional couple of cities.
Additional 20 cities. So we started with 8-9 of them.
Yep.
Took us 2 years to introduce it. Now it's working. And that means that 3 times a year, we measure how the situation is in the programs and in the processes to build.
Yep. So you made some agreements with those municipalities. This is the data I want. This is the process we're going to follow. Their people are trained and used to, after 2 years, what to do. 3 times a year, you extract that data into a common data environment, into one, let's call it a database for the sake of easiness. Then you can see, okay, this is what's promised. This is your plant capacity. And this is what we thought would be able. This is the actual schedules. If you compare those two together, are we at the right track?
That's what we do. And actually, we ask by convincing the municipalities, and we subsidize them also to introduce those programs.
Yep. Well, that's what's
money
in your...
Money always helps, you know.
Yeah, money always helps, of course.
And don't forget that there have been, in the past 10 years, huge budget cuts on every municipality in the Netherlands.
Yep.
So they don't have the money free to start new programs.
Yep.
So they think, well, when they look to the sky, it can work.
Yep.
It works, of course, but there is no control.
No.
And I think that's not okay.
Because you don't have leverage
at all.
Okay.
So when you plan your processes, everything has to be in it.
Yep.
So that there are no things that are all of a sudden coming in and, well, it costs you always money.
Yep. In one of your articles, you said the municipality of Amsterdam is doing this for years. There's a lot of knowledge on scheduling. You actually have a project management.
Since
1996. That's quite a long time. Before I was working, I know how you have been held by Primanet in this case on this project management, on this project controls. You take those lessons learned and a big pile of money, which you have. So you don't have bricks. You have some budgets and not endless, of course, but you can help them say, okay, this worked in Amsterdam. So why shouldn't it work in Zaandam or Haarlem or whatever city we are talking to? And then they are convinced, okay, let's try it. Not try it, let's do it, because it's not a pilot. Yeah. It's actually working. And this is coming into as results. So now you can report over.
Yeah, another example is the programming of what you build.
Yep.
How much social, how much expensive, and so on.
Yep.
When you have to close a business case, that's always the point.
Yep.
How much social housing can you afford yourself in the budget case?
Yep.
And this is what politicians want to know. How much social and affordable housing is built?
Yep.
And what you see in your processes when you run your planning systems, almost in the end of the process, when you're already almost building, the program is changing most of the times in favor of the more expensive because it brings in more money and it closes your business case.
Yep.
And that's where the discussion goes about when we want to have social housing, who pays the bill for that?
Yeah, because that's...
And
it's a political thing.
In comparison with who earns a lot of money on this.
Yep.
So what is socially acceptable in revenues on housing in the region here?
Yeah. But that's a hard trade-off.
The main thing is that the politicians, and they are my boss, want to know how much social housing is there to be built.
Yeah.
Affordable housing.
Yeah. But I can imagine that's a very, very strong discussion you need because what you said, we want to have commercially, 100% commercially is paying a good bill, then we have money more than enough.
Yeah.
If we do 100% of the social housing, we don't have the money, but all the people in the municipalities are happy, or the majority is happy. That's the trade-off you need to make.
That's the trade-off. And remember this, in the city of Amsterdam, over 60% of the people can't afford a house which is more expensive than 150,000 euros.
Yep.
And when you know that the average price of a house now in Amsterdam is over the 450,000,
yep,
then there is something wrong. And when you don't work on that, then you see that how your society gets more rich people.
Yeah.
And no cure and care for the people who can't afford that expensive, yep, houses. And those houses are most of the times only expensive because there are a lot of revenues to get there.
Yeah. I was watching the news this weekend, and I think in Cornwall, southwest of England, they are actually throwing people out of the house because they can ask more money to tourists or Airbnbs or the people from London, etc. So it's not just an Amsterdam issue. I think it's a global issue, at least a European issue.
Let's say on dense areas.
Yeah, on dense, highly dense areas, and of course because people are paying it. People are paying now 400,000 euros for a house which was 350,000 euros last year, and nothing changed. It's the same brick, it's the same windows, etc. So is this also a new bubble which is created? Well, we're not the investors, but I think it's running.
Well, I'm hoping that we come to our senses.
Yep.
And that the investors also come to their senses.
Yes. In a controlled way, and not in like 2008 in an explosion way.
Of course, in a controlled way. And that's why we started with the climate change. I think we need a lot of money to change our building process, to build different houses, and that money has to come from anywhere, from somewhere.
Because
I know where I want to get it. It's not acceptable to have huge revenues. So when you have huge revenues, I think we have to tax them in one of or another way. Or they can voluntarily, of course, invest in climate adaptive houses, which is okay.
The government said, for example, we want to build gas houses without the gas. Gas line, so not running your stove and your heating, etc. On gas. That takes a lot of money. Are you saying it needs to come a bit from the political environment, but also from the commercial environment, that people can say, okay, you can build these commercial houses, and in favor for that, we need a fee or tax to support the local or the social area?
We talk about morality. You talked about people, profit, and tools.
Yeah.
Well, this goes about people and profits.
Yeah.
So, we can work very good together when we know that we are integer, that we have normal profits.
Yeah.
So profit is okay.
Everybody needs to buy.
Okay.
Yeah.
But in these times, high revenues, buy.
Yeah. And over the back of people who need a social house or a lower.
The result of a lot of profit is that another group of people don't have that money.
Yeah. Can't buy a house.
Pay 50% of their income to housing.
Yeah. Thus, for example, there is this new law that you, if you sell the second or the third house, you need to pay more taxes to the government, not the 2%, but the 8%. Because I think in the news, but that's the hearsay part, that's not helping enough. Because people still, there's so much money to be earned that they can afford the 6%. It helps, but
it looks a little bit like window dressing, of course.
Yeah. Okay. One of the other challenges I've seen from your articles and from the data which is available, for example, from Central Bureau of Statistics, is that the infrastructure is not ready for the growth. So there are not the connection between city A and city B is there. Public transport is not overall everywhere available. So if you want to build a new city or a block or a suburb or whatever you want to call it, people want a train station or a bus station at least. This is the job.
We Dutch are different, you know. So in the rest of Europe and most places in the world, they first built the railway lines.
Yeah.
and then build the cities.
Yeah.
Here in the Netherlands, we build the cities and then have a discussion about
how to get the train into the city.
How to get there.
Yeah.
Well, that's different in Holland than the countries around us. That's right.
But we need to look, and I think that's probably your job, is to have everybody look at the same problem or the same challenge to say, okay, agency of railroads, public works, Rijkswaterstaat is responsible for the roads and for the channels, etc. ProRail is, among others, responsible for the railroads. Let's sit together and draw a train station first and then a city around it. That's a really traditional, or that's a really reset of your mindset, of the complete.
Yeah, there's another thing, you know, everybody's also in his own pillar working.
Yeah.
By law, the National Railway of the Netherlands, NS, they're the only one who are allowed to build stations.
Yeah.
So when in the city center, we want to integrate a station.
Yeah.
In the whole social working of the system there.
Yeah.
The shopping, the leisure, the learning, the public space, and the housing. It goes all together, but the stations are only permit to build by National Spoorwegen.
Yeah.
Well, that's strange, you know. Why can't the developer do that? Make one building in which the train is arriving.
Yep.
Well, that's one of that's a pillar thing.
Yep.
So everybody is in his own pillar watching to solve the problem.
Yep.
And we want to connect them and have a discussion about an integral program.
That's what you're doing, for example, with this data. You can see all the data together. We should have an overall schedule or an overall program with the responsible. So with the political scene, with ProRail, with Dutch Railways, with the contractors. Yeah,
yeah. And also the systems give you also the possibility to have the right discussion. So when I, for example, is said, well, then we need more places to build houses. The answer is no, we have 500,000 places. So not the problem.
Yeah.
But
the perception is different because everybody thinks.
The perception is different. And also, municipalities, they don't work fast enough.
Yeah.
Well, actually, when you have a lot of NIMBY behavior in your city, it's not easy to solve the problem then. Eh?
Yeah.
And then the alderman and the mayor and the alderman has to go in discussion with their community.
Yeah.
Which is very reasonable. So I don't say that NIMBY behavior is not okay, but it comes from somewhere.
Yep.
And you have to discuss the somewhere. And also the people in the community say, we want more houses for our children, but they have to be built in the garden of my neighbor and not in my garden.
Yeah. Yeah. Everybody wants it. Who wants chains?
Have a discussion about that. Why?
Yeah.
Why? That's not. We build communities, so that's not community behavior.
No.
And we can't solve it down then within time.
No. That's where the people empower the mayor and the aldermen to talk on behalf of them. That's where the voting system is, the democracy is based on. The not in my backyard, so everybody wants to chase, but not literally in my backyard. With this new generation, do they think differently? Because that's the older traditional way of thinking. Do you see it in newer suburbs or in Almere or in those Phoenix locations?
That's a very good question. I think there's a shift going on.
Well, also with the shared communities.
Yes, and the community behaving is also changing. And also the needs for younger generations, though it's a discussion point.
Yep.
They accept smaller houses, but the quality of the public space has to be perfect.
Yep.
Because the public space is part of your social environment.
Yep. I've seen buildings with shared kitchens and shared leisure spaces. Huh? Why does everybody need to buy their own couch?
Yeah, but on the other hand, some people say they do have that behavior because they can't do anything else.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the chicken.
House is too expensive.
Yeah,
I don't know. Here in the city of Amsterdam, it works, and in other denser cities as well, let's say Haarlem and Zaanstad and Almere, it works as well. And I see a younger generation that's coming up, which is very well equipped in their mindset and also in the things they want to do.
So, We touched Corona very shortly a couple of minutes ago. I think one of the things COVID said, we need to be more at home. So I don't want to work directly in the city center, but I want to work near a forest or near a park or in a greener environment. Does this run from the city to the more less dense cities, for example? Does this help your challenge, or do you see the impact of people sitting in their houses?
We have also on the verstedelijkingsstrategy,
strategical
view we are developing, but how has the city of Amsterdam or the metropolitan region of Amsterdam, what way do we develop it?
Yeah.
And we said, well, we want to do that polycentric, not making the apple bigger and bigger and bigger.
And to eat all the other cities.
In Paris, is that the lifetime experience about how old you can become is 10 years shorter than in the city center.
Yeah.
So the more, let's say, easy social environment, you can reach that and find that in cities like Haarlem, Zaanstad, Alkmaar, Purmerend, Hilversum, Almere.
They breed a city environment, but they are not as dense as Amsterdam.
Not as dense.
Yeah.
So there are enough plans, and we want to build there over 65,000 houses.
Yep.
So Amsterdam becomes bigger, but not as quick as other metropoles.
Yeah.
But the cities around the metropole, polycentric, they do develop. And that's what we're working on in the program, reachable cities, bereikbare steden.
Yeah. Reachable means good interconnections between those things. And I think
reachable for a public transport, reachable by car,
financial,
reachable for your career, reachable for your affordability. So there's a lot of reachable.
Yeah. Is there the opportunity to solve this big challenge in the surrounding cities?
I think it's one of the opportunities.
One of the opportunities. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much. It gives a good insight into the challenges of what you are facing as metropole region. One point I want to touch as last, buildings shouldn't be built at the places we are going to live. They should be built outside. Is that, we talked about wooden buildings, which don't need to be built at the spot where you're going to build. Prefab is coming up very, very strictly. Modular building, where you can say, okay, this is a standard house with option A, B, or C. What would you like? Would you like a bigger garage or a bigger study, for example, depending on the individual needs? Are you also supporting these kind of, you said, well, startups are very good at it. I've seen a lot of startups in this region with wood and 3D printing, etc. Are you also supporting them, the people who actually need to build the houses? Are you supporting them as well as metropole region, or is it more
We do. We have also steering groups in which there are representatives as well.
Okay.
We work also with the triple helix, as we call.
Yeah.
So there's public, private, and science together. That helps a lot in working faster. So you could say it's kind of open source developing we are doing. And in that way, we support that as well.
Yeah. And does that help the proof to the municipalities to say, okay, there are people who can build faster. Let's keep it simple. Let us as political creatures say, okay, let's redesign our process. If they do the same repeatedly, we can assess them quicker, for example, because every single house by architect needs complete redesign. But if they have a good process, our legislational process, for example, can go quicker.
Yes, I think so. And that's what you started our conversation about uniform
processor.
Processing. We are working on that as well, but then only on the. We are looking at how do you do that and how much is to be needed to make uniform.
And uniform on that. Not standard, huh? Not 13 in...
Exactly. Yeah. That's the question you just asked. That goes about individuality.
Yeah. I want to keep my own identity.
Yes, I live there. In that house, with that window, you know, and that color.
Yeah, that's my house. Yeah.
So there is a little tension in it, but I think it's solvable, the problem.
Okay, okay. I read in one of the articles, I read a lot of articles about, at the end of this year, officially you can go retirement, but you choose, I think very explicitly, to connect to the metropole region for another couple of years.
Yeah.
What's the fun out of this? What's the value Lex Brands is bringing home to your love? I hope the same love as 30 years ago with the seven children on the bronze table in a Sunday.
Yeah.
Where is the enjoyment of this work? Where do you get your smile moments?
I think the climate change is that important to work on that I cannot look to my children and grandchildren and say, well, I'm 60, what, 66 or so, job done.
Yep.
Why?
Yep.
The world is burning, as we know, as we see in the newspaper.
Yep, as we speak.
And when I have the possibility to help and it's accepted that I'm helping,
yep,
it's okay. When it's not accepted anymore, I stop.
Yeah, yeah.
Or when my children say, "Well, you old man,
go get a hobby. go fish.
Go home, March.
Yeah,
it's okay.
Yeah,
that's
but great. I see the people side in you. Hey, you still have the passion when you say, "Okay, I can help social housing. I can help youngsters buy or rent reachable, affordable houses where they can live and start their new families." That should be part of the legislation.
Decision makers and the professionals, people, profit and tools.
Yep.
So let's say where I'm helping is people and profit.
Yeah, okay.
People and process.
People, processes, and at the end, that the profit is very important.
Because the profit is for everybody there.
Yeah, because the profit...
Not only profit for one party, but for...
Shared responsibility. And profit is not only money. Yeah? A good environment. Yeah? If you're an investor and you look into Amsterdam as a great city to live in, that should also be something where you go smile off and not just a big bank account.
I'm still in love with Amsterdam.
Yeah,
of course.
I can understand. Thank you, Lex. I think we also want to we can talk about this for hours. And I think if we're going to talk about Amsterdam, we can talk for days. I still see the smile, the passion on your face when you talk about it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's also, if we look at the ProCon podcast, people in projects are very passionate. Huh? They're really passionate about their project. Huh? Yeah. You have helped building the Havengebied, or you have built the municipality of Amsterdam or the metropole region. And I think that's also very unique to the project and program business, where it's a small world at the end. It's a very niche market. And that's where the ProCon podcast wants to connect to people and see you smiling. And that's where we have the cameras for. See you smile, hear your enthusiastic face on this. Thank you very much, Lex Brands. Please, for everybody on the podcast channel, visit proconpodcast.com, where you can see Lex Brands talk about this project or in the previous we recorded several. Thank you for tuning in. Please look at it at your own pace. Apple, Spotify, of course, is available to you, but also the ProCon podcast. Thank you very much. Until the next time. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening to the ProCon podcast. To listen and watch more episodes, you can subscribe and access the resources mentioned in this episode by visiting proconpodcast.com. We look forward to seeing you on our next episode, where we will continue to lead the project controls conversation. The ProCon podcast and the associated resources is published under copyright to PrimaNed. All rights reserved, no reproduction of this content is permitted.